if we move into core and CAL licensing, I want to bring this together in the by discussing Windows Server and System Center. And these generally are not the same thing, and but they're often tied together, and they're often sold together as well. So if you look at what the license in the core and CAL licensing section, you have core licenses that are available for Windows Server Data Center and Windows Server Standard. There's core licenses available for System Center Data Center and System Center Standard. And there's something called the Core Infrastructure Suite, or CISS, which are a combination of Windows Server and System Center. And you have these also in the Data Center and Standard flavors. These are all the products that you want to have to license and manage your Windows Server estate. Both Windows Server and System Center do have prior version rights. So if you buy a single license of Windows Server 2019, you're able to use Windows Server 2016. Then you have the client access licenses. These are the licenses that you assign to devices or users to be able to access a server environment. And you have these in this section, you have these in three different flavors. You have the standard Windows Server client access license. And you need to buy the correct version of the client access license for your environment. Meaning if you have a Windows Server 2019 environment, you cannot access that with a Windows Server 2016 client access license. You need a Windows Server 2019 client access license. You have additional licenses for client access that you can buy, for instance, for remote desktop services. This is for session virtualization. And you have the rights management services client access license, which is for additional security features. Windows Server does require you, if you have external users accessing a server, to license that server with an external connector license. And you have these also for RDS and RMS. So again, a little bit more on client access licensing, because for some of you, a client access license might be a new term. A client access license is what it says, the ability for a client, either a user or a device, to access a server environment. So in this part around core and CAL licensing, you need to do two things to be licensed correctly. You buy the amount of core licenses that you need, and we go into that in the coming slides, and you need to buy the amount of access licenses for your clients, either user-based or device-based. It's nothing more than the right for a client to access a server environment. You can mix user and device CALs, meaning if you have devices that you share with many users, it might make more sense to buy device CALs for that. And if you have a lot of users using multiple devices, it might always make sense to buy user CALs. If you have these different types in your organization, it might make sense to buy both of these. User CALs are usually a bit more expensive than device CALs because they, as Microsoft states, hold more value. So if I have a laptop, a telephone, a tablet, another device that I use to access my my email somewhere, then it might make sense to buy a user CAL for all the devices that I have. And as such, it holds more value. So typically a user CAL is 1.5 times the price of a device CAL. So summary, licensing core and CAL basics, purchase the amount of core licenses for each server running a Windows Server environment, and purchase user and or device CALs for any devices and or users accessing these server environments. So how does buying core licenses work? As a basic rule, and this is quite important, any server needs at least 16 cores assigned to it with a minimum of 8 cores per processor, Why this number? Back in the day, before the core and CAL licensing, it used to be processor and CAL licensing, and Microsoft said you need to license each processor and you need to assign a client access license to the devices and users that are accessing these servers. Now, when they moved to core-based licensing, because the amount of cores in servers started to grow and grow and grow, that it didn't economically make sense to keep licensing it on a processor basis, they said, okay, but we don't want to cannibalize on the processor-based licensing. So what we're going to do is find a minimum threshold that you need to license each server with to not lose any of the revenue that they used to have. So 16 cores in this model equates to the same price that it used to cost to buy two processor licenses. So that's the minimum, the bare minimum that you always need to assign to your servers, 16 core licenses. So on the screen, you see three different examples. And I've stated the amount of cores that you need to license in case of each of these servers. So on the left-hand side, you see a simple example, two processors, each with 8 cores. So you need 16 core licenses. But in the second case, it's a very strange looking server with one processor and 4 cores. Well, it, as said, it's not as simple as assigning 4 cores. No, you need to buy 16 cores to correctly license this machine. And what happens if you have a server with 4 processors and 12 cores per processor? Well, then you even need to buy 48 core licenses to cover that server correctly. So this is how they explain that in the product terms. You may use the server software on a licensed server, provided it acquires sufficient server licenses. As described below, the number of licenses required equals the number of physical cores on the licensed server, subject to a minimum of 8 licenses per physical processor and a minimum of 16 licenses per server. Data Center Edition permits the use of server software in any number of operating system environments on the licensed server. And Standard Edition permits use of the server software in 2 operating server environments on the licensed server. Standard Edition permits use of 1 running instance of the server in the physical OS on the live server if the physical operating system environment is used solely to host and manage virtual operating system environments. We'll come back to this in a bit, because this is a difficult way of explaining something very simple. So if we look at point 5, as long as the total number of licenses and physical cores remains the same, license reassignment is permitted at any time customer repartitions a single piece of hardware. So this is an additional reassignment right that you have specifically for these core licenses. As a one-time alternative to assigning base client access licenses per user or per device, a number of base CALs may be dedicated to an instance of the server software on a single server to permit up to the same number of users or devices to concurrently access that instance. And again, below there is a little bit about access licenses, and that's just as easy as I explained it earlier. So if we look at the different editions of Windows Server, Standard and Data Center, they have the same licensing model, but they have different rights associated to it. It used to be that it was they used to have the same feature set, but with the evolution of the product, it has changed over time. But the main difference is in the virtualization rights. So with Data Center, you're allowed to run the server software on the physical operating system environment and an unlimited amount of virtual machines. So you license your hardware, and when you've licensed your hardware, you can run as many VMs on top of that. With Standard, you're able to run the software in 2 operating system environments on the server and on an additional 2 VMs or virtual operating system environments. This means there's a 1-to-1 ratio between the operating system environment you license and the amount of VMs that you are able to run, which is 2. However, if you want to run more than 2 virtual machines or virtual operating system environments and license with Windows Standard, you can stack the licenses. So if you have 4 VMs that you're running on a Windows server and you want to license with Standard, you can buy additional licenses for Windows Server Standard and stack them on top of each other to allow for the additional virtual machines. If we look at System Center, the management tool from Microsoft, it is quite a similar story to Windows Server, except you don't need any client access licenses for this. The reason that I discuss it here, as said, is because they're often sold together. Microsoft wants you to buy Windows Server. Obviously, they don't require you to manage them with System Center, but they would like you to. That's why they released the Core Infrastructure Suite as well. They think you should manage your servers with System Center, but obviously, they're never going to require it. If you look at the differences between Standard and Data Center, there aren't many, and they include all the System Center 2019 components, either Standard or Data Center. It has the same functionality. You can manage any workload. It includes the right to the management server software and gives you SQL Server technology rights. One big caveat here is System Center. You can only always buy this with software assurance. So when you buy System Center, it contains all the product's components. So this means that you get Configuration Manager, Data Protection Manager, Endpoint Manager, Operations Manager, Service Manager, and Virtual Machine Manager. You license the servers that are being managed, not the management server itself. So if you have a management server, you do not need to license it with System Center, do not need to count it towards System Center license requirements. You only need to license the service that you are managing. Moving on, Windows Server has what we have discussed earlier, down edition rights. You can install any lower edition and version of the Windows Server license that you buy. And why I am going to stand or explain a bit more on this is that in the current setup of the Windows Server product, you know only a data center and a standard license. But in early versions, you used to have three editions. You used to have a data center edition, an enterprise edition, and a standard edition. Now, with your Windows Server 2019 licenses, and pretty soon Windows Server 2022 is going to release, I don't expect big changes to the licensing model in that sense, but you can go down edition them to any earlier edition. So if you have a Windows Server 2019 data center license, you can down addition these to enterprise or standard if you want to. And if you have a Windows Server standard license, you can down addition them to enterprise or standard. So if we look at software assurance, there are additional benefits here that you might be interested in. One of the biggest benefits for Windows Server is the Azure Hybrid benefit. Looking at Microsoft Azure, you can use the software assurance licenses that you have for Windows Server in Azure to reduce your licensing cost. So if you buy a virtual machine within Azure and you want to run Windows on it, usually you buy the base compute price and you pay an extra premium to use Windows Server on top of it. If you use software assurance on your Windows Server licenses, you are able to reduce the entire Windows charge from your Azure virtual machine. More on this is there's an interesting video on our YouTube channel that it goes very deep into the Azure Hybrid benefit. I won't do that here for now. Semi-annual channel releases for companies who innovate quickly. So you get to be on a certain quicker release schedule. You go into a semi-annual release in that sense, whereas usually they're releasing once a year. You get the ISEMA annual release, and this is also available for server subscription licenses. Server subscription licenses are licenses that you can buy in CSP, but it grants similar rights for software assurance rights to these subscription licenses. You have the option to buy extended security updates. So if you're using a version of Windows Server that's no longer supported by Microsoft, and you still want to have the security updates from Microsoft to keep your environment secure, then you have the option to buy extended security update licenses when you have software assurance on your Windows Server. Specifically for RDS license with software assurance, you can use these to access a Microsoft Azure environment. Nothing fancy here, and just do note that the 90-day reassignment restrictions still apply. And as stated earlier, there's no license mobility. If you're using an outsourcer, you're required to license Windows Server through your outsourcer or through Splaa.